It was centred around a gang known as the Chelsea Headhunters. Undercover officers from the Metropolitan Police infiltrated the gang, leading to 8 arrests. There followed similar operations at West Ham and Millwall, where 16 people were charged. But all are now free. The cases were either dismissed at court or on appeal because of concern about how the officers' statements were compiled. Chris Henderson and Stuart Glass were accused of being Chelsea headhunters. They face charges of conspiracy to cause an affray and assault. But when their counsel questioned the evidence, the trials collapsed.
At the time, I fitted the stereotype from the media of your typical football hooligan. I had short hair, tattoos, overweight, and to the average policeman or to the average person in the street, you know, I looked like a thug. So I feel that's the reason why they targeted me. They'd follow me around everywhere, supposed to stand next to me in pubs, you know, stand on the periphery of a circle of people and overhear conversations, and then go and jot down certain bits of the conversation on programs or bits of paper in the toilet, and then come back and listen to more conversation. I feel they made a decision about 6 or 7 months before they set up their operation, and as far as they were concerned, I wasn't an innocent person they were going to follow to see if they could gather evidence. I was a guilty person, and they were gathering evidence to prove that I was guilty.
Scotland Yard declined to comment, as Operation Own Goal is now being investigated by the Police Complaints Authority. Nevertheless, Superintendent Appleby still sees undercover operations as an essential part of a more sophisticated approach to dealing with hooligans.
Obviously there has been some problems, but there have been problems in other trials. I think the will in the police service to combat football hooliganism is as strong, or if not stronger, than it ever was. I'm sure we're now getting the tools together and the sophistication to combat it effectively, and I think that the legal structures are also going to assist us over time in that respect.
But covert operations remain a high-risk strategy. They're time-consuming, expensive, and they can miss their target. Many senior police officers now believe the way forward is to be one step ahead of the hooligans, and that means more sophisticated intelligence gathered in a variety of ways.
Villa Control 599, we are aware of the situation and have it in hand, over.
Yes, they've got 2 shows going to set the complaints.
All First Division clubs now have closed-circuit television cameras monitoring crowd movements towards and inside the grounds. At most high-priority matches, police helicopters equipped with cameras are on duty. The Football Trust has spent £3 million supplying specialist video equipment for police use. This officer observes one section of the crowd more intent on inciting the opposing fans than watching the game itself. Then there are teams of officers known as spotters who work on the ground with video and photographic equipment. They're building up files on people who are believed to be hooligans, and part of their job is to find them on match days. This team work at all Chelsea matches, searching streets and pubs. They're looking for about 50 individuals. They find they build up a strange relationship with their targets, who become increasingly familiar.
I think it's the game that they used to play. As long as we feel we've done our job properly and they've seen us, then that's the end of their time. I don't really think any more about it. I'm certainly surprised how friendly we almost are.
Gathering intelligence is seen as a crucial factor in the future strategy for dealing with hooligans.
Intelligence tells us what is going to happen. It helps us predict, if you like, future actions of hooligans. If we can get our intelligence honed down to such sophistication, the policing of football in this country will change radically.
But while most observers agree that radical change is necessary, not all are convinced that more sophisticated policing is the way to achieve it. Some fear it will only make the hooligans more sophisticated and call for more fundamental changes. Instead of viewing all fans as potential hooligans, they say the police should involve supporters much more closely, Only in that way can any long-term changes be made.
I think police are beginning to communicate their intentions to supporters, but I think a great deal more needs to be done in that regard. And I think they would do well to not only communicate their intentions to spectators, but also to consult them, because I think supporters and supporters groups are a rich fund of knowledge about football and it needs to be tapped.
You cannot have a situation where people come on Saturday afternoons and are confronted by aggression all the time. There has to be some give and take between fans and police. And to a large extent, that does apply. I think most policemen, especially policemen who are policing a ground all the time, every Saturday, they do appreciate the need for decent relationships with fans.
But not all are so optimistic that any lasting change can be achieved.
People will always fight in football, or in the pub. It's human nature, you know, I mean, it's just not a football thing, you know, I mean, it's just the way life is.
Making inroads against soccer hooliganism can at times seem like an impossible task. Critics are many, and cooperation from even the law-abiding fans is minimal. Any advances against the hardcore hooligans come as a result of painstaking and often dangerous work.
Is the intelligence coming through to us, Aaron?
Absolutely, yes.
And the countdown to what is potentially the biggest flashpoint of all, the World Cup, goes on inexorably.
The world will be watching how the English fans behave, and their behaviour will reflect on this country, so it concerns me greatly. What I am saying is that the only power, the only authority I have in Italy is to give their policing authorities intelligence and information and knowledge on how British hooligans behave and the best way they can combat it. Having done that, my hands are tied.
The British police are determined to press ahead against the hooligan, but translating what they learn at home to the day-to-day policing of the World Cup is an assignment of a different order, and they remain apprehensive about the challenge.
If the slogans on these T-shirts are anything to go by, then the omens for Italy 1990 do not look good. The nightmare returns. But these are all part of the hype. The crucial question is, will the Italian authorities take on board the inside information that the National Football Intelligence Unit gives them? And what's more to the point, will they be able to use it?
Turin, Juventus versus Verona. Italian police have their soccer hooligans too. These are not gentlemen from Verona, but 500 of Italy's most violent fans. Filming is risky. At the club's previous two matches, police had to use CS gas to break up street riots. Today, they're taking no chances. Like their British equivalents, the Italian police keep the fans moving and their presence is thick on the ground. But these policemen carry revolvers and rifles and they're in no mood to stand any nonsense. The Italian way of policing soccer violence is to let the fans know that they step out of line at their peril. But because violence isn't organised in the way it is in Britain, there's little need for undercover operations. To the Italian police, all soccer hooligans are the same.
They need help from England. They need help from English policemen and intelligence men. I think that the question is a political one. In other terms, the Italian police is proud of its organization, and I am not sure that they calling for help from English police.
Judge Francesco Palmer is the chief coordinator of security at the World Cup. As far as he's concerned, he welcomes help from England.
Io credo che la polizia italiana collaborerà pienamente.
The Italian police are quite prepared to adopt the advice of the English police in order to find the correct solution to these problems. Nevertheless, these problems will be on Italian territory. Therefore, the Italian police will, of course, maintain their autonomy.
Some senior English policemen who have already talked to their Italian counterparts have returned expressing concern. Italians don't have one police force, but several, each jealously guarding its autonomy. These are the state police, When it comes to controlling a football match, they split the job 50-50 with one of the other forces, the Carabinieri. They literally split the ground down the middle, with the state police at one end and the Carabinieri at the other. The English police fear it's a recipe for confusion. There's also concern that the Italian police may not fully grasp the kind of English hooligan they'll face, full of lager and national pride. John Williams has just completed a report for the Council of Europe on the 1988 European Championships.
There is an association now between the patriotic fervour supporting the national side, the importance of showing continentals what it is about Englishness that you find important, and for the English that appears to be being willing to stand up for yourself, not running away in certain situations, showing continental supporters that the English can be tougher in certain situations.
I can't say whether the strategy of the Italian police will be as sophisticated as that of the English police. Because, of course, football hooliganism in England is long-standing and has obviously been studied and analysed to a great extent in that country.
The threat of violence overshadows what the publicists are selling as the greatest spectacle in football history.
Its main objective is to give us a great show. And by us, we mean both the fans of the matches and the viewers watching at home.
To ensure that Italia 90 is a showcase for football and not drunken hooligans, over 1,000 police are expected to be on duty at all the key matches. But in the past, this kind of saturation policing has been seen by English fans as a confrontation waiting to happen.
The Italian police, in my experience at least, have tended to wait for things to unfold, wait for incidents to develop, and then move in and seem to be as interested in punishing the offenders as actually preventing the thing starting. Now, if the Italian police adopt that kind of strategy, then I think we may be in danger of seeing what might be actually quite small problems escalating.
The Italian police force is capable of showing great efficiency and has demonstrated in the past that it is both civil and democratic. But it has also had to deal with terrorists, who of course create much more difficult problems than football hooligans.
But where are the Italian police going to come under greatest pressure? The National Football Intelligence Unit has told Public Eye that it expects around 8,000 ordinary English fans plus 500 hooligans to travel to Sardinia for the preliminary games. When England play Holland, around 4,000 Dutch supporters with 400 hooligans are expected to arrive on the island. There's an obvious potential for trouble. But the problems may be greater if England qualify and play on the mainland. Then, in the jargon of the terraces, the English fans may go steaming in. That's running amok.
I think that quite possibly the main problems are going to occur when England go onto the mainland. Where they're going to playing and who their opponents are is very much an unknown quantity. It's possible that we could end up getting a team like Argentina. And when we get to that stage, tickets are going to be available. Very short notice, we could have major problems.
We must not look at this problem in terms of being in a state of war. Indeed, we will not be arming the police as if they were about to fight a battle. However, if football fans in whatever numbers create disturbances, then the police will have to respond in the appropriate manner.
There's no doubt that in England, in the wake of the Taylor report, there is an even greater political determination to tackle the problem of soccer violence, and considerable progress has already been made. But Italy is a different question. This summer, the world will see not only the biggest spectacle in football history, but the biggest test ever in the battle against the football hooligan.